Hey everyone, this is Dr. Casey Johnson. Thank you so much for taking time to listen to the Unlock Wellness podcast. I know you're going to love today's episode with Lynsey Brewer. Lynsey is doing some amazing work, so I'm excited to have her on the show again. If you've been loving the Unlock Wellness podcast, be sure to jump onto iTunes, subscribe, and write a review. It really helps me out a lot, and I really appreciate all of the feedback and support. The Unlock Wellness podcast is now on Patreon.com. Patreon is an amazing site that allows you to support your favorite podcasts. So whether it's a dollar per month or 10 or 20, it's an amazing way to help support the Unlock Wellness podcast. If you're unable to support at this time, I still love you. The podcast will always be free. But the podcast has been growing a lot, and using Patreon will help me slowly improve recording equipment so I can get you guys the best sound quality possible, as well as help me decrease the need to use sponsored ads in the episodes. I'm definitely not against sponsorships by any means, but I do respect your time as listeners, and I don't want to have to overload the podcast with a bunch of ads. So if you do want to support using Patreon, all you have to do is go to patreon.com/drkaseyjohnson. There's even fun incentives for supporting, like shirts and stickers, so be sure to check it out. Also, be sure to follow me on social media to keep up with the latest podcast episodes. The best way to connect with me is on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. My username across the board is at Dr. Casey Johnson. That's DrKaseyJohnson. You can also check out my website at drkaseyjohnson.com. It has all of the past podcast episodes and more information about each guest under the Listen tab. While you're on my site, also be sure to check out the Shop tab, where you can check out my first book of my Healthy Children's Book series and learn about the Unlock Wellness Project, which supplies a wellness bag to a child in need for each book purchased. Thank you again for listening. I hope this episode leaves you feeling inspired to start making positive changes to your health. Now it's time for today's episode. I hope you love my conversation with Lynsey Brewer. Welcome to the Unlock Wellness podcast. I'm Dr. Casey and excited for today's guest. I'm here with Lynsey Brewer. And Lynsey Brewer is actually a past podcast guest and actually also happens to be my best friend since first grade. So I got to throw that in there as well. But if you haven't heard her story, go all the way back to episode 22 to check it out. And it's crazy, Lynsey, that we're already at episode, I think this is going to be 141 when this comes out. So that's pretty insane that it's already been that long, but I'm excited. So today's episode is actually going to be pretty cool because since she's already been on to share her story, we're going to be diving in and talking about ways to really help people break bad cycles with their health. You know, I've had a lot of really inspiring guests on that come on that talk about how they've really transformed their health. And everybody's gone through like these cycles, these up and down, like yo-yo dieting, and they lose 20, gain back 40, and like things like that. And it's super interesting to me that people can go through all of these cycles and then all of a sudden they break the cycle. So we're just going to be diving into ways that Lynsey and I really feel that transform your health and get out of that cycle and start making positive changes that are actually sustainable. So Lynsey, thank you so much for again coming on. We were talking beforehand and she's actually the first guest to come on twice. So it's, no other person I'd rather have do that first because I love you, Lynsey, but excited to have you.
Thanks for having me. I'm excited.
Yeah. So
part two,
but yeah. So before we get going, Lynsey, for people that maybe newer listeners and they haven't been since episode 22, if you just want to just give a quick recap on just who you are, where you're from, and maybe a few things that you talked about first time that you came on. So,
sure. So my name is Lynsey. And as you mentioned, so we grew up together. We met at the very beginning of first grade and originally from Charleston, West Virginia. And, growing up in West Virginia, I know that my lifestyle was probably a little bit more unique than a lot of the families, especially in this day and age with technology. And, you know, it's just easier to live a more sedentary lifestyle now, I think. But, I was really fortunate in the sense that I played a lot of sports growing up. I was pretty much always active or involved in some sort of activity. I had, you know, I have two older brothers, so that alone kind of kept me on my toes. And was really lucky to have a family that didn't really eat out much at all. My mom, you know, even though she was working and her and my dad were getting us to and from sports and all of our activities, we always, you know, ate dinner as a family, home cooked meal, that kind of thing. And while a lot of people might nitpick those kinds of things, you know, like, and I'll be the first to admit that looking at some of the food whenever I go home, and not even just in my house, but just in that kind of location, you know, Southern food is not right. Typically light. But you know, even though we were eating at home and it may not have been always been the healthiest of meals, it was still, you know, we had more control over portions and the ingredients that went into the food and that kind of thing. And we could always scale it if we needed to and those kinds of things. So again, while I know that I had a very unique and I'm very happy that I was always so involved in sports and got to meet a lot of really great people and positive influences on my life, and that kind of carried through. That was a really great foundation for me. So that kind of carried through, you know, through high school and college. I always stayed active, and over the years, my nutrition and, you know, the types of workouts and things I do to stay active have kind of evolved. Some have stayed the same, but I've grown a lot in kind of opening my mind and trying out new things. And it's really nice because obviously your body, you know, your body changes, and your, you know, like your spiritual health, your mental health, all that kind of stuff, they all play together, and you know, that changes as you grow. So I've been really thankful that I had such a good foundation. So
yeah, and so I think something else we covered in that episode too, and yeah, I definitely encourage you to go back and listen to the whole thing. But I think a reason that I really wanted to cover this topic with Lynsey is because she's very consistent with her fitness. Like that is not hard for her. She thrives at that. And I don't, there's different roadblocks that people have when they're first starting out. You know, some people are better at staying consistent with the nutrition. Some people are better at staying consistent with the fitness. But I think it's when you try to throw too many things at once is mm-hmm. when a lot of people start to struggle, because it's like, that's not...
You can't do so many things well if you're doing so many
right.
things.
Right. You can't master it. Like, yeah. You know, maybe, you know, I always, you know, encourage... It's hard because it's so many people could go different ways. But obviously, you know, you and I both know that true health, you know, starts in the kitchen. Like if you want to be more active, you're going to have more energy, obviously, if you're fueling yourself with mm-hmm. the right ingredients, right? So maybe you start by making a few switches in the kitchen, or even starting with a green smoothie in the morning instead of the, you know, like the cereals and things like that. And just noticing how you feel over time, it's just a domino effect. And then maybe a few weeks later, you have more energy to work out. So it's just sure. thinking about those small steps. But have you had things that have really helped you, Lynsey, to stay more sustainable, especially on the fitness side? I know people will do good at first, and then it's, oh, I'm too busy, I'm too tired, those kind of things.
Sure. So I kind of had the advantage of having, you know, sports as a good base, but you know, before I kind of shifted my mindset on, you know, switching from a sports-based workout to, hey, I'm finished with sports, now I just kind of have to do this on my own. And it was, I know that's where a lot of people do get intimidated, because, you know, there are things that you have to consider. You know, you want to make sure that you have good form. You want to make sure that your body is able to kind of actually perform the exercises. So it's not like you would just hop into running a marathon, you know, right. in the first right. couple of months. You want to build your strength. And a lot of that, I think, comes with the mindset that I had was, you know, I view working out as and getting my exercise in as an appointment that I make with myself. So people give me a hard time all the time because whatever I have planned for the day, and I'm not saying that, you know, life doesn't throw you curveballs and that kind of thing with your schedule, but for the most part, the day before, I already have a good idea of what my workout schedule is going to be for the week. And then I always, the day or the night before, kind of just like look at my day ahead, see what either my work schedule is, any, you know, outside of work commitments I have, that kind of thing. And I just adjust it if I need to. So for example, whenever I have to travel, even if I have to get up, say my flight leaves at 6 and I have to be at the airport, you know, by 4:30 or 5, I know it sounds absolutely crazy, but I will set my alarm and I will make sure that I get, you know, a quick 30-minute workout. And it doesn't have to be anything crazy. I want to get my heart rate up. I want to get my body moving.
I have been witness to this, people. This is a real thing.
It is a thing. And but it's I know that I'm going to be, whether it's going to be, you know, a flight to the East Coast that can take, you know, an entire business day to get over there, or if it's just me going, you know, either just like a one-stop flight, whatever the case is, the reality is that I'm going to be sitting still for at least 3 or 4 hours if you factor in, you know, travel to the airport, sitting at the airport, sitting on the flight. You know, it's just your body is designed to move. And so the energy that I get to, a lot of people have a hard time. I get that not everyone is a morning workout person. I didn't used to be one at all. But I personally don't drink coffee, tea, that kind of stuff. So it was very eye-opening to me once I realized that I could do a morning workout and that alone would wake me up. And I know it sounds crazy to a lot of people that I could get the energy from that some people would expect to get from coffee. But I'm telling you, I don't drink coffee. And after you get your heart rate going, your endorphins start kind of moving around a little bit, you feel good. Your brain is, it's like it stimulates your brain. You're ready to go. And I think just kind of having the mindset, you know, like I said, like this is an appointment that I made for myself. I know how good I'm going to feel afterwards. I know how important it is for my, you know, for my health, both physically and mentally. You know, it's such a good, it gives you such a good mindset to start your day. And I, you know, because of my schedule, I used to only work out once a day. Now, because of my schedule, I actually have to break it up into two. I shoot for 30 minutes. So I do a little bit in the morning, a little bit in the evening. And it was a little bit much whenever I first started. And I did have a little bit of a tough time adjusting, but you know, that's what I needed to do because of my schedule. And then I ended up realizing it's actually really great because 30 minutes, anyone can find 30 minutes. If you want to, you can find it. And so it was a great way for me to start my day on a good note, you know, get the ball rolling, feel energized, that kind of thing. And then, you know, go to work, run errands, whatever it is I'm doing. And then once I get home and settled and I'm ready to finish the other part. So whether it's, you know, cardio in the morning and then weights in the afternoon or vice versa, whatever it is, it's also a really great way to decompress. So it's a great stress reliever, whether it's at the beginning of your day, in the middle or after, whenever it is most convenient for you. You know, like I said, anyone can find 30 minutes in a day.
And even if like you're newer and you're trying to get started, I like the concept of breaking it up. If that's better for you, even if you have, you know, some people, Lynn, that might even be like, they have the time, but just mentally that sounds better. You know, maybe they want to work out. Maybe they want to start off at 20 minutes a day. Mm-hmm. You know, working out for 10 minutes right when you get up and 10 minutes after your day. That doesn't, I mean, obviously anybody can do that, you know?
Sure.
It's a mindset game. I mean, all of it is, honestly. It's just making this part of your lifestyle. And then once it becomes a habit, you don't, it just becomes who you are. And that's what you said, people give you a hard time, but it's, if that's what's important to you, like that doesn't matter with the thoughts of other people.
Sure. And I think too, with, it's interesting once you kind of figure out, and again, you know, everyone has their own preference on the type of movement that they're doing. You know, like I personally am not a big Zumba person. I know that people will only do Zumba, and power to them, because I can't, but you know, like that's what they enjoy doing. They, you know, their body's moving. And again, our bodies are designed to move. And so once you kind of find what works for you, you'll actually start to realize that you begin to incorporate it in ways when you don't even mean to. So like there's little things that you can do. I think I mentioned this on the last podcast, but there are days where I do drink. I have a 32-ounce Hydro Flask, big bottle. And so there are some days at work that I'll bring that in, because if I have a lot of back-to-back meetings or if I have a lot of work to do, I know I don't really have the availability to get up a lot. Mm-hmm. So I'll bring that just to make sure that, one, I'm staying hydrated, because keeping your body hydrated with water and not filling it with soft drinks and that kind of stuff, that will actually help make you energized, as opposed to what people think soft drinks do, which is give them energy, when in reality, it really does bad things to your body. But I, instead of bringing the 32 ounce, I actually opt for, you know, like those red plastic Solo cups or whatever. And because, one, it gives me an excuse to get up more often. And when I get up, I always take the longer route to get back. So it's not a lot. I mean, it's not a huge difference in steps, but it's making my body move a little bit more. You know, if I see that I have an extra 10 minutes in between working on projects, or if I finish with a meeting and I just kind of need to step away for a little bit, instead of just going and kind of messing around on my phone or on the internet, I'll go outside and I'll just walk a lap around the building or around the parking complex. And it doesn't have to be this huge commitment. I think that people are afraid of the pressure that a lot of people put on the thought of working out. And mm-hmm. I get that, because there have been times where even someone like me, who, you know, this is what I've enjoyed doing for years, but there is a pressure from society that you have to have this hardcore workout and, you know, you have to do all this crazy stuff, when the reality is that's not it at all. Your body just needs to move. And the benefits from that, I mean, you know, as you know, I mean, you could speak to this better than me, you know, blood pressure, keeping your heart rate down, it reduces your risk for diabetes. You know, it's crazy how much a little bit, taking care of your body, even just a little bit, does for your overall health.
Yeah. And I like how you mentioned it and brought up just your joking about Zumba. But it's just like, that's what it's all about. It's not all about Zumba, but it's all about like finding that activity that really makes you excited to do it. You know, maybe if you've been in that like up and down yo-yo diet with your diet or your fitness, maybe you're just, you know, maybe you're not into the type of workout that you're doing and you need to switch it up, or maybe you have to switch things up with how you're eating, you know, like, there's just so many variations that you can try. You know, I know for myself, you know, I was trying to lose the same weight for so long. For me, what broke the cycle for myself was switching to plant-based, and then it all took care of itself, but it took me so long to figure that out for myself, you know? And and sometimes that all that it takes is finding out what works for you. And then obviously that gets you excited. You become passionate about it. And then it just becomes part of your lifestyle. And it's all a process, you know, it doesn't all happen overnight, obviously. But once you find that thing that really works for you and you're excited about and you really enjoy and you love how it makes you feel and your body's obviously healthier, I think that's really huge, especially for people at the beginning, just figuring out what you like to do and what works best with your schedule, like you were saying.
Yeah. And I think too, kind of to piggyback on what you just said, I think another big thing is I think the big thing to keep in mind is, you know, remembering the reason, and it does take some reflection to find out what your true motivating factor
like your
is,
why
or your right. why. Yeah. And I mean, I know mine has changed over the years, and that's totally normal. I mean, yours can change every week, but the important thing is that you do keep that top of mind. And I think that it's, I'm not saying you have to tell the world. If you want to tell the world, kudos to you. But, you know, just find a few friends that you can share that with, and that, you know, kind of more for an accountability side of things. And same thing with your diet, you know, whether it's your diet or your workouts, whatever it is, just share it with a few of your friends. And if, just say like, hey, this is something that I'm really trying to work on, and I'd appreciate it if you could help hold me accountable. I know I'm not going to be perfect, but you know, your support and you kind of holding me accountable will help me actually not just hit this as a short-term thing. You know, this is more of a lifestyle change, and it's important that you have those friends that are going to be able to support you, because I mean, I do it with you all the time. How many times have I texted you and said like, hey, I'm kind of in this nutrition funk. I feel like I need to switch things up a little bit, or I need to focus more on, you know, reducing XYZ. And,
right.
And, you know, within like a few minutes, you're like, yep, try looking at this website. You could try these recipes. And I think it may sound silly, but I think, you know, just having those few people that you can kind of call on, not saying that they're going to have this, you know, miracle response that's just gonna light everything up, but you know, like, you want to be able to depend on those kinds of people, because right. I mean, you want to surround yourself with positive influences, whether it's, you know, some books that you're reading or people that you're relying on. That's your support. That's going to help you get through kind of those harder patches and or those harder weeks, whatever.
Yeah, no, 100%. It's all about the community, and I think that's another big obstacle people face is just they don't feel like they have the support, and they're afraid socially what will happen, right?
Sure.
So that's what with like Facebook and Instagram, those kind of communities could come into play and be so helpful because, you know, for example, I mean, there's a lot of people that listen that are plant-based vegan that listen to this. You know, if that's new for you and your friends and family, that's not where they're at. Like, there's so many people that you can connect with, you know, myself included. You know, you can, you know, shoot me a message, but having those kind of people and those kind of communities where you can just see what they're doing and what they're eating and reach out if you have questions, like, it's a game changer. And then when you have that, when you're in those situations, then it doesn't really matter because you feel like you have that support, and you're always learning. Like, kind of funny example, I recently, I went on a family vacation with my husband's side of the family, and there's, you know, almost 20 people, and we all rented this house, and they assigned a night for people to cook each night and like into groups basically. But like I'm basically me and Maddox, who's my daughter. She, we're the only two people that are vegan. So, yeah. So each night Maddox and I, we kind of just, we cooked our own thing. We ate our own thing. And you know, they were super supportive. You know, obviously there's the few jokes that they mean well, but it's just like, it's getting to a point to where it doesn't bother you that you have to do something like that sometimes, but at the end of the day, you know, they're still going to love you. You know, it's just getting to that place that you're okay with that. Do you know what I mean?
Sure. And I think too, that, you can speak to this probably better than I can. Just kind of preparing yourself. So like, if you think that you're going to be put in the situation. So for me, a lot of the, part that I struggle with, and I don't have to travel too often, but traveling is always the wild card because you never really know, you know, like what resources you're going to have. Like, is the airport yep. going to have decently healthy options? It's, you never know. It's kind of hard to say, but
it's going to be a fruit cup.
it's really tough, but similar to, you know, like what you were saying with your meals while you're on vacation, you kind of just figure out a little bit of a game plan beforehand. You say like, all right, well, I know that, you know, we're likely going to be the only ones that are, you know, following this kind of a lifestyle. So, and that's not saying that other people have to change what they're going to do. It's just saying that you know, you're going to kind of prepare for what you need on your side. And that's totally fine. So, for people that travel, there's a lot of things that you can do. I typically, although you can't bring actual water bottles in through security, you can always bring an extra just empty water bottle. And every airport now has those water filling stations. So one, you save yourself, you know, $10 for a bottle of water in an airport.
Right.
You can also, you know, you know that you already have access to water, and if you already have the water, you're not going to be tempted to buy, you know, a sugary drink and that kind of thing, especially, you know, flying already makes your body feel so off. You feel bloated. You feel it's just crazy how it affects your body. So
they all have the water stations now?
To my knowledge, yes. That's and cool. Even if they don't, I mean, if you have your own water bottle, most restaurants or anything, they're not going to charge you.
Right.
Starbucks obviously gives water for free. So that's a really good option. And two, there's, you can always take snacks and stuff. And so I like, just for quick and easy, I like Lara bars. And you know, whether you want to pack fruit there's so many different things that are easy to travel with. And another thing that I do, whether I'm traveling for business or just for fun, is I like to, wherever I'm going to be. So if it's for a work trip, I like to see, you know, if there's like a, just a little grocery store or something similar nearby where I can just go and grab a, you know, like $10 to $15 worth of stuff to have in the room with me. So on the meals that I actually can control, at least I know that I have a good eye on what I'm trying to, what I'm trying to eat whenever I'm not, you know, whether I'm with clients or whoever. And then as much as you can, just try and look up restaurants and their menus and those kinds of things beforehand, because you're way less likely to go for an unhealthy option or something that isn't in your normal diet. If you're more prepared, you won't even consider the other options. If you know that there's a salad on there that you've already looked at and it meets kind of your standards for whatever your diet is, then you don't even care what the other options are. So there's a lot of those kinds of things that kind of remove the temptation and do help you stay on track whenever there is a lot of, you know, variables that can get in your way.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you brought up the travel aspect of it too. Cause I think because you brought up the restaurants and just kind of we were talking about the social setting, people are afraid of that too. They think that they can't go to restaurants and they can't go out with their friends because they can't eat like a normal person. And then because of that, they say it's too hard. Then they're back to where they started. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned this on a past episode but I think it's important because, you know, when people are going to order for, you know, people just don't want to be difficult, especially for if you are somebody that does eat plant-based and you're eating at just a regular restaurant, mm-hmm. people are afraid of being different or being difficult with the waiter. But it's really not being difficult. There's so many things, like you can switch things up if there's sides, or if you see avocado is on one salad, but you want it on this dish, like you can mix and match stuff. And that's not it's really not a big deal.
I guarantee you will not be the only person asked.
You're not the only person. And honestly, I'd said this before in a podcast, like the person serving you, they're not concerned with you ordering something different. They're worried about, is this person going to be nice to me, or are they going to be super rude? And you know, if you're friendly and you're just super nice, nobody's going to care. Like it's one of those things we kind of build up in our heads because we're really, really afraid to be different than the crowd, but it's really not a big deal. And, I promise you, I'm the person making some crazy concoctions everywhere I go. And it's, you know, it's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, I think that there's and it's interesting too that you say that a lot of people it's almost in the moment, you know, and I get it. If you have a lot of stress going on, whether it's personal stress or whatever it is, it's so easy to let yourself use those little things that can just kind of knock you down a little bit as an excuse to just throw in the towel. And I think such a big part, and it kind of goes back to figuring out what your motivator is and your why and that kind of thing. Because at those times where, no one's perfect, so you're likely not going to have a 100% accuracy on your meal or on your week, you know, between workouts and nutrition and that kind of thing. You know, we're all human and life happens. But I think the big thing to remember is, you know, that's why I said revisit your why often, because your why can change. And that's going to be the reason that, you may not have a great dinner one night, but guess what? You know, new day tomorrow and you get to start afresh. That's the beauty of life. So, you know, and it's good to not let yourself get too hung up on those little imperfection moments, because if you look at big picture and long term, that's such a minor little hiccup, and it doesn't, like I said, it may not make you feel great in the moment, but you can't hold yourself to have that much pressure. I mean, that's where people kind of get in a little bit of a bad place, and you know, it becomes almost like an unhealthy thing because they're not doing it for the right reason. They're putting too much pressure on themselves. And I mean, I can attest to it on the fitness side. There was, there were probably a few months where I was going through a lot of stuff personally. And, I knew that working out was, and you know, eating healthy and eating right. That's the stuff that I know makes me, I'm very in tune with my body, and I know that's what makes me feel good. And, but I went through this little patch of being, you know, really overwhelmed and just had a lot on my plate. And I can't tell you how many times I would go to the gym to work out, and I would either, you know, do a couple of exercises out of my lifting workout, or I'd only be able to get on the treadmill for, you know, a minute or two. And I would just get, cause my head just, I couldn't get all the stress out. And even though I knew that that's what I wanted to do, and I would get frustrated and I would leave, and then I would get back home and I would get even more frustrated that I gave up. And it's like, no, I can't do that. So I kind of shifted I took a step back and I kind of let myself realize, you know what, I know that's what I'm used to doing right now. I can't really do that, and that's okay. So my compromise was, I'm at least going to go walk for 30 minutes. I may not be able to do this crazy workout, but I know I can walk. So it's kind of like, yes, things might not always be what you're anticipating or what you plan, but it's good to also just listen to your body and kind of be able to have a backup plan and listen to what you need to do for those times.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's all about those kind of self-awareness, that self-awareness, because if you can be okay with that in that season that you're going through at that point, maybe that's just a week or two, then you're not going to get off track in 3 weeks. And all of a sudden, like, it would have been easy for you, Lynsey, to be like, okay, I'm going to not work out for a month, eat whatever I want. But then a month later, you have a whole
you're
lot
gonna
of
be
work.
In a worse place.
Yeah, right. So it's just doing those little things, maybe going on a walk, like you said, just whatever you can do to keep moving forward. Maybe you're not moving forward as fast as you were, but you're still taking steps every day to get a little bit further, you know, inch a little bit further.
Sure. And I think keeping your goals in mind, that was a big reason on why I wouldn't let myself, you know, just throw in the towel. It was, you know, like I was saying, just because those days weren't perfect doesn't mean that they, how do I say it? I still had, you know, the big picture, I guess, in mind. And so that's why it was easier for me to say, you know what, that's okay. I'm going to do this. And that's still going to, you know, I'm still going to be moving. I know that I'm still going to get some of my endorphins going. And that can also help me feel good. Just because I'm not going exactly down the path I wanted to doesn't mean I can't still reach my goal.
Right. And I think having those type of goals, especially like we talked about in the first episode you came on, Lynsey, like having a goal, if you've never, you know, had any type of fitness goals, like doing a 5K or doing a race or doing something that you can work towards, to where you have to do something every day, or that event is going to not be very fun, you know. And it's when you have that feeling of accomplishment after you do something like that, it's contagious. And then all of a sudden you want to start doing more and getting better. And it's just like this domino effect for amazing change. You know, I can't remember what episode, obviously everybody, I mean, Josh Lajani is, you know, he's super well known right now. He's amazing. Lost, gosh, I mean, definitely over 200 pounds. And now he does like ultras and just crazy running. But I mean, it started with, he signed up for like, I think his first race was a 5K. He was extremely overweight. I'm sure it hurt a lot. And that was his start, but he finished it. And then the nutrition came into play. And just, you know, it's just like, it's cool when you set a goal and you just start working towards it and you actually accomplish it, how much that can really just set your whole life in motion.
Oh, I agree. I agree. I had helped get races organized and, you know, I'd always been involved in fitness, but it wasn't until I moved out here that I did my first actual race. And as crazy as it sounds, it's totally a thing. Like once you do one, you just kind of get hooked. And since then, I mean, I've done, gosh, I don't even know how many races I've done. 4 half marathons. I'm doing my 5th in the fall.
It's awesome.
Lord help me, but I think I'm going to sign up for my first marathon.
You're going to do it.
It's going to be in December. So it's crazy that, you know, I moved out here about, it's almost 7 years ago. So in 7 years, I've already been able to build myself up. Don't get me wrong. I definitely had to work my way up to it, but I've already been able to accomplish all of those things. And I didn't have any, other than playing sports, I really had no background in running, you know, longer distances. But like you said, it's just interesting how those kinds of things kind of help you, one, realize what your body is capable of. It's an amazing thing. You know, even people that are overweight or they're struggling with, you know, whatever the health problem is. And I know that those goals seem so unattainable sometimes, but if you can just, you know, make a plan as good as you can. And like you and I've talked about before, it's not an overnight thing. You're not going to just wake up and be able to bust out a half marathon and be eating perfectly clean and everything's going to be, you know, that's not how it works, but you can make a plan to just start chipping away at these small changes. And over time, those small changes are going to be what ends up making the biggest difference. And that's what makes the difference between a quote unquote fad diet and a lifestyle change. You want to be able to set yourself up for long-term success and not just, you know, a couple of weeks of looking good.
Right. No, that's perfectly said, Lynsey. And I mean, I love everything that you're doing. You're amazing. And I definitely encourage everybody that's listening to go back, listen to her episode on episode 22, hear her whole story, give her a follow on social media. That way you can keep up with the different races that she does. She's going to start being more active on Instagram because I'm going to make her be more active on Instagram. So go give her a follow. And Lynsey, what is the best way for people to give you a follow on there?
On Instagram, I'm just at Lynsey, Lynsey 1003.
Perfect. Yeah. So go give her a follow. And Lynsey, since you are the first repeat guest and you get to answer this question again, I hope you remember your first answer so you can give a different one. But if you have another piece of advice for the audience, maybe it's something that really helps you along your wellness journey, but what would be another amazing piece of advice that you could give the audience?
I think really just so, I know it isn't exactly what I said the first time, but just kind of piggybacking off of that, just remembering that regardless of who you are, where you're at in your journey, as far as whether it's on the fitness side of things or the nutrition side, whatever it may be, just try to remember that there are so many resources out there that can help you reach your goals. And there's always going to be a community to support you. And, you know, just remember to prepare as much as you can. That'll help you kind of dodge the curveballs. And that's really going to be the best way to set yourself up for success.
I love it. Lynsey, thank you so much again. I obviously loved having you, and just everybody listening, go give her a follow on Instagram. And just Lynsey, just thank you so much for coming on.
Of course. Thank you.
Thank you guys so much for listening to today's episode. I hope you loved my conversation with Lynsey. She's doing so much positive work, so be sure to give her a follow on social media to keep up with everything that she's been working on. You can find her social media links that we talked about in the episode in the show notes, but you can also find them on my website as well at drkaseyjohnson.com. That's drkaseyjohnson.com. Click on the Listen tab. Then from there, you'll be able to see all of the past guests that have come on the Unlock Wellness podcast, read a little bit about each guest, and be able to click on their social media links, websites, all of that. So all of Lynsey's information can be found on my site as well. If you guys loved today's episode with Lynsey, be sure to jump onto iTunes, subscribe, and write a review. It really helps me out a lot, and I really appreciate all of the feedback and support. Also, be sure to check out patreon.com/drkaseyjohnson to learn how you can support the Unlock Wellness podcast. Thank you guys so much again for tuning into today's episode. I hope you loved it. I hope it inspires you. And most importantly, I hope you take action.